We assume, and again we have to guess, that all these books were put together on scrolls. But if you've got books on separate scrolls, the scroll of the former prophets, the scroll of the 12 prophets, great Isaiah's scroll, the scrolls of the law of Moses, what order do you keep them in? Our Old Testament, the books are in a fixed order, and we've got the books of Moses at the beginning and we've got Malachi at the end. But there were many different orders for the Old Testament, many different possible orders, and no order at all when it was still written on scrolls. The scrolls were usually kept, the ones in the synagogue would have been kept in the ark, the very special cupboard, but the scrolls at Qumran, those that were found down by the Dead Sea, they were kept in huge jars with heavy lids on them. And this was the very practical purpose, because you didn't want things getting in and eating them, and scrolls were very valuable possessions. So how did the books that existed on separate scrolls come to be the Old Testament in the order that we know it? Now, the Christians were the first to make an extensive use of the book form, what we call a codex form. Separate sheets written on both sides, folded over, usually four sheets folded over to make eight pages. And when this happens, of course, you can eventually bind them together in a book and you can have your books in a fixed order. But in the time of Jesus, we don't know which prophets he would have called the prophets. And so in Luke chapter 24, when Jesus is talking to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, we have Luke saying that he explained to them from the law and the prophets the things concerning himself. And here there is a big problem, because the discoveries found among the Dead Sea Scrolls show that there was at that time more than one version of the law of Moses. And there was no fixed number of prophets. And so we don't know exactly what Jesus would have included in his list of the law and the prophets. And this is a very serious matter for Christians, because some early Christian texts, for example, the letter of Barnabas, have quotations from scriptures that we can't recognize. Barnabas doesn't say where he's getting his quotations from. He just says, as it is written. And we look at this and we say, well, where is it written? So we're not sure which books the early Christians regarded as prophecy, and we're not sure which version of the law of Moses they would have regarded, well, also as prophecy, because they regarded all scriptural books as prophecy, particularly the Psalms and the law of Moses. And this is a great problem, because the texts, the Bible texts that have been found among the Dead Sea Scrolls, can be dated reasonably certainly to the pre-Christian period. And so we know that some Hebrew books had a different form before Christianity than the Hebrew text which now forms our Old Testament. And if you look at what Jesus is saying on the road to Emmaus, he sets out in the prophets how it was necessary for the Messiah to suffer and enter his glory. You won't find that text anywhere in our Old Testament, but you will find it in the Qumran version of the prophecy of Isaiah. So we can be pretty certain that the version of Isaiah that Jesus knew was not exactly the same as the one that we have in our Old Testaments. And there are many other examples of this, where Christian proof texts, for example, the one in Hebrews 1:6, let all God's angels worship him, that is not in the Hebrew that underlies our Old Testament today, but it is in the Hebrew of, in this case, Deuteronomy, that was found among the Dead Sea Scrolls. So one of the questions we ask when we talk about how the Old Testament books were collected has to be, who decided which books would go into the Old Testament, what we call the Old Testament canon, and second, which version of those books? And that is a very big question. Now, it looks as though, and again, this is informed guesswork, the selection of Hebrew texts that was going to become the Jewish canon, the Jewish holy books, was decided 20 years or so after the destruction of Jerusalem in 70 AD. And what is now our familiar Old Testament canon emerged at about that point. And sometime later also, the version of the text that was going to be the canonical text, that was also decided. And as a result of this, so many early Christian proof texts cannot actually be found in our Old Testament. And that raises a whole lot of problems. Were the Christians using different versions of the Old Testament? Well, clearly they were. Was the fact that the Christians were using them a criterion used by the Jewish rabbis when they decided which version they would adopt? And so we have a kind of proof text battle going on. Again, this is guesswork, but that's certainly compatible with the evidence that we have. Now, going back a little bit before these events, these momentous events at the end of the first Christian century, we know that during the time of the Second Temple, there was a lot of emigration from the Holy Land to various other parts of the world. Some of the Jewish exiles who'd been taken to Babylon didn't come back. They settled there and made the great Jewish communities in that part of the world. Some people went to Egypt. We know Jeremiah went to Egypt. And it's the Jews who went to Egypt and prospered and multiplied there, became a very important factor in the great city of Alexandria. Eventually, they lost familiarity with the Hebrew of their scriptures. And so there was a need to have the scriptures translated into Greek. Greek was the everyday language of Egypt at that time. And the story is that the king of Egypt, Ptolemy, wanted a copy of every book in the world for his great library. And so he summoned scholars from Jerusalem with Hebrew texts to come and to translate for him the law of Moses. And six scholars came from each of the 12 tribes. So we know this is a bit of a story because the 12 tribes weren't really functioning at that time. And these 72 people went and they worked and they translated the Hebrew scrolls of the law of Moses. And it was miraculous because all the translations agreed. And then the story develops and it becomes the story of 70 scholars who worked for 70 days and they produced the Greek Old Testament, which was known as the Work of the 70, and in Greek the Septuagint, that's what it's called. And the Septuagint became the scriptures of the Jewish communities scattered around the Greek-speaking Mediterranean world. This scattering is called the diaspora. And the diaspora communities of the Eastern Mediterranean were the communities of Jews where Paul went on his missionary journeys. And so Paul would have used the collection of scriptures that was in Greek. Now, the legend of the 70 only applies to the law of Moses, but the other books were translated little by little over a very great period. And at the same time, also, the Jewish community was producing, in Egypt, was producing more books that they considered holy books. And so by the time the rabbis in Palestine were determining which book should be part of the Hebrew Old Testament, the Greek-speaking Jews in Egypt and elsewhere had not only the books that they had translated from Hebrew into Greek, but also additional books that were simply in Greek. And so already in the time of Christian origins, there were two different versions of the Old Testament, and the Christian communities around the Mediterranean were using a much longer Old Testament than the one that was used by the Jewish communities. And this is how things progressed. And other translations were made locally. Latin-speaking communities had various versions of what we call the Old Latin translations. And this persisted until around 400, when the Pope decided that, you know, they really did need to have one Latin version. And Saint Jerome was commissioned to make this Latin version. And he famously went to the Holy Land and set himself up to translate. And he used what he believed to be the true Hebrew text. But the Hebrew text he used was the one that the rabbis had chosen at the end of the first Christian century, and was rather different from the one that the first Hebrew-speaking Christians had used. And so Jerome's translation of the Old Testament into Latin, which eventually, after a very long time, became the Bible of the Western Church, is in fact based on the Hebrew that could well have been established to exclude certain Christian claims. And this is an enormously important fact to bear in mind when we're looking at the Old Testament. And the books that were not in Hebrew but only in the Greek Old Testament, Jerome classed those separately, and these are the books that Protestant Christians now call the Apocrypha, and they're often sold separately or indeed not included at all in a Protestant Bible. So the whole question of how we got our Old Testament is very interesting indeed. And it's important for Christians to remember that we call this part of the Bible the Old Testament. We do not call it the Hebrew Scriptures, because the Christian tradition is of using the Greek Old Testament, and that is far wider than the Hebrew Scriptures, especially in the post-Christian Hebrew version that became the basis for the Old Testament in Jerome, and indeed with the vernacular translations at the Reformation. So there's great pressure to be politically correct and talk about the Old Testament as the Hebrew Scriptures, and in fact, the Hebrew Scriptures is precisely what it is not.